Herbert O'Driscoll, who is a noted priest and preacher in the Church of Canada. And he writes about the men and the women during Jesus' time as though he were interviewing them and talking to them personally. So I would like to read a brief introduction to Luke that I have here, and then speak a little bit about the uniqueness of the Gospel of Luke. And finally, what importance this is to us today. And I quote from Herbert O'Driscoll. "I imagine Luke with a white coat and a stethoscope, even though I know he could not have had a stethoscope when he wrote the Gospel, or with something that conveys the power and magic of physician's place in our lives. We met at a medical conference where I had been asked to give an address on some aspect of ethics. A number of people came up after the address to express appreciation, ask a question, offer an insight. He waited until the others had gone before introducing himself, looking almost exactly as I had expected. About my age, dressed quietly and tastefully, I got the impression of some sophistication, an easy self-confidence, a slight hint of amusement in his eyes. He suggested lunch. Of all the evangelists, I said to him after we had read through the menu in order, you are the one I have wanted to meet the most. Why? He inquired. I hesitated at a loss for an answer. It's always so much easier to say that one likes something or somebody than to say why. Because when I put your two books beside the others, I said, Mark seems like a tabloid, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. And Matthew is a bit too much like a bureaucrat with all his lists. Luke looked as though he wanted to interrupt. I paused to hear him say amusedly, surely you're not going to try to tell me that I did a better job than John. For a moment, I was taken aback. No, I'm not going to say that. I think what I want to say is that I still prefer your gospel to John's, even though comparing what you and John wrote is like comparing apples and oranges. We both know John, what he did is magnificent. But what I like about you, now that you force me to define it, is your ability to tell a good story. I'm glad, he said. That's what I wanted to do. Actually, that's what I had to do if I was going to get them to read it. Them? I asked. The Romans, chiefly. Of course, there were always others. You couldn't live and practice in a huge city like Antioch without coming across all kinds of people. But it was the Romans who really mattered in those days. Getting their attention for something and you were all right. On the other hand, get them annoyed and you were in trouble. Is that why all your Roman characters come across as decent and attractive people? In a way, yes. The fact is, many of them were. I've noticed how many people these days make stereotypes out of the characters in the Gospels. All Pharisees are self-righteous. All Romans are cruel. All Greeks are wise. That sort of thing. Truth is, there were all kinds, even among the original community of followers. I should know. I tried to meet as many of them as I could. Well, that's a bit of an introduction about Luke, and I feel like that is kind of an intriguing way, even though it's made up, but it gives us a little insight into what it might have been like to be with Luke about who he was. once an American asked an Englishman if he could recommend a good book on Luke, a good book on Christ, and the Englishman answered, "Have you tried the one that Luke wrote? The Gospel according to Luke has been called the loveliest book in the world." Having said that, we know that Luke is quite different from the other three Gospel accounts in its uniqueness. And there's a richness, I think, that we must look at. For me, Luke writes for the Gentiles. We know this, we've heard this time and again. It is clear that he wrote mainly for Gentiles. Theophilus was a Gentile, as was Luke himself. Remember, Luke begins his dating of the birth narrative from the Roman emperor and the current Roman governor. The Roman dates come first. Unlike Matthew, Luke is not greatly interested in the life of Jesus as the fulfillment of Jewish prophecy. In fact, he very seldom quotes from the Old Testament. He never uses the Jewish term rabbi of Jesus, but always a Greek term meaning master. When he is tracing the descent of Jesus, he traces it not through Abraham, but through Adam, the founder of the human race. He was trying to write not for the Jews, but for the people, very much like ourselves today. I think a second very, very important high point for me, and an extraordinary one for his time and his day. In the Gospel of Luke, he gives a place to women that was unheard of, that was extraordinary. You may have heard this story. In the Jewish morning prayer of the day that was said by men, a man always thanked God that God had not made him a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. The birth narrative is told really from Mary's point of view. We read of Elizabeth, of Anna, of the widow of Nain, the woman who anointed Jesus' feet, the story of Martha and Mary, and of Mary Magdalene. So you find in his gospel that women have a very prominent spot in the ministry of Jesus. Something very, very unusual for that period of time. As a look at the readings for the Pentecost season and cycle C of our church lectionary series, the Gospel of Luke is very prominent. And I'm struck time and again by the portrayal that Luke gives us of the man Jesus and his ministry. It is a gospel with all of the barriers broken down, with Jesus Christ for all men and women and children without distinction, period. Remember how the kingdom of God is not shut out to even the Samaritans, as we recall the famous parable of the Good Samaritan. And the healing of a leper who was of a Samaritan descent. Gentiles are even included in a very prominent way where Orthodox Jews of the day were considered these Gentiles unclean. Remember the story of Naaman, the Syrian, also the Roman centurion whose faith is praised. It is through the parables of Jesus and Luke that the poor and the oppressed are stressed and held up. Luke is so very interested in the poor and the down and out. Remember Mary bringing an offering for her purification? It was an offering of the poor. Then there is the parable of the rich man and the poor man. Interestingly, too, in Luke's account of the Beatitudes, of the Sermon on the Plains, as it's called in Luke, Jesus, unlike Matthew, did not say, "Blessed are the poor in spirit," but simply and clearly, "Blessed are the poor." A very subtle distinction, but one of utmost importance. More than the other Gospels, Luke portrays Jesus as a friend of outcasts and sinners. And he alone tells the story of the woman who anointed Jesus' feet and bathed them with her tears and wiped them with her hair in the house of Simon the Pharisee. Or then there's the story of Zacchaeus, the lowly tax collector. And I guess all of us are so familiar with the story of the prodigal son and the loving father. All of these examples for me are an indication of how Luke viewed Jesus' ministry toward the poor, the oppressed, the outcast, the sinful world that he ministered in. And so Luke gives us a picture of Jesus that's so compelling. You know, I think we need to see this book called Luke as a whole, as a unique picture of Jesus Christ. And you know, for several hundred years, there was a group of Christians who knew only about Jesus through the eyes and the words of Luke. That was their Jesus. It wasn't until a number of years later where there were all of a sudden four stories of Jesus. A second important thing for me as we remember who Jesus ministered to, and Luke said how who was important to Jesus, we have to ask the hard question of ourselves. Do we in our Christian faith, in our daily living, in our congregation, do we reflect this Jesus that is seen and portrayed in Luke? And more importantly, does our congregation and its ministry reflect this ministry of Jesus Christ as seen through the eyes of Luke as he tried to tell us that unique story of Jesus? If not, maybe we need to look at our vision and our mission statement and our giving, our emphasis here, to better reflect Luke's picture of Jesus. So every time I get a chance to talk about Luke's position, I'm always reminded of his great contribution to our understanding of Jesus Christ, who we worship every day and confess every day. It was through Luke that we saw a picture of Jesus that is a little unique and a very wonderful and opening to us as Christians. One thought that I am reminded of as I go through life is that Jesus did break down the barriers of all who God loved, and God accepted, and God cares for. Luke was very instrumental. And also, for those who still think that women have a place in the church, but it is kitchen, or maybe in the back row, Luke doesn't say that. Luke reminds us that women, like men,